focus.
Interesting. I don't know how to pronounce that, but it says that it's this type of moth.
That does not look
accurate. It is a moth. Cool.
Moth.
Well, it's not a moth yet, but...
Well,
Mr. Morrill, I was right.
It is a moth. Yeah. It turns into one.
It turns into a moth, right?
Yeah.
Does it say, what type of moth?
Halicida tota.
Well, that's a scientific name. Those are hard to say.
Yeah.
What's a common name?
Does it doesn't say.
Okay.
It doesn't have one. It's that fancy.
That's a pretty moth. And this shows you.
It's a pretty awesome caterpillar.
Right? This shows you where it lives.
Oh, no, there's one right there, too. Look.
This tree is infested.
Interesting.
So the closer you look at something, right? Sometimes you just have to stare at it.
I think it's staring at me back.
Is it staring at your back? This is our forest study plot. This was a project that we started in September of 2018 with the Connecticut Audubon Center at Pomfret and the Harvard University Art Changing Forest Program.
You're sure looking.
You said tent caterpillar.
The goal of Art Changing Forest is to engage students in both understanding how forests change and sort of thinking about how forests change, and also understanding and engaging with the scientific process. How do we collect data in a way that we'll be able to use it to quantify our observations? 60, 70, 80, so we're getting bigger. They're the ones collecting this data. They'll also be the ones looking at it. That sort of helps make numbers on a page much more real when they were the ones who actually measured them, and also helps them to sort of grapple with the inherent messiness of scientific data and of nature.
So we're using the Inaturalist app on our phones, and the students are taking different pictures of some of the plant life here in the plot, and they're identifying what they think is a common name along with the scientific name, and then trying to figure out where this can be found in America or beyond. Is it invasive or is it a natural species?
Did you get the caterpillar over there, the fuzzy one?
Yeah, she got that. Mm-hmm. She's going to have to fill in the scientific name and these other...
When students are going out, they are taking measurements and making observations that they record on data sheets. And then that data gets recorded onto an online database, which comes to us and is shared on our website so anybody in the public can access that data. And we want to tell a story with that data.
I want you to be thinking about a few things today as you are taking your observations. One of the things that I want you to think about is how a forest changes. We need to think about all those different ways that forests change, both slowly and quickly over time. You are all going to sort of be forest detectives. And you're gonna try and look around you and think about how you could imagine seeing this forest in the past and how it might look in the future. And I also want you to just look around for stuff that's cool. So anything that like is weird or you haven't seen before or that you might be excited about, there's some really neat mushrooms in here. There's all sorts of plants. We've seen a whole bunch of insects. Look at all the different leaves and you can see the sky through some of them, right? You can see which ones have been eaten.
A lot of the theme that we have in the Art Changing Forest project is related to land use and therefore the impact of human choice on what we end up seeing for our forests.
When we went to Harvard, the Harvard Forest this summer, one of the things they showed us was their diorama project. And that was fascinating to see in the 1800s that lots of the areas that we drove by on our way to the Harvard Forest, they were essentially clear cut for farming. And when they look at them today, a lot of those forests have regained their standing, their previous standing. When we talk about resilience, our planet is amazingly resilient to a point.
Understanding the context of the decisions that you make and understanding that your role in the landscape is small, but it's part of a patchwork of a bunch of different decisions that are being made. We try to build that context for students so that they can understand that their little forest plot that they're studying is a part of a larger whole that's changing over time and that we as humans have a real role to play in forming a future that we all want to live in.
We've been really fortunate to have our state board of education and our local board of education adopt new science standards. And those standards call for a focus on human impact on the environment. Our science teachers have been working really, really hard in making sure that we engage our students in meaningful learning experiences and really analyze and evaluate what's going on.
It's definitely interesting to be trying to find things and be investigating. It feels like you're a little bit of like a scientist, I guess you could say.
Our goal is to talk about connectiveness. So how are we connected to the things around us? How are we connected to each other? What is their story of their belonging in a place like this? And why is it important? And why is it important that they figure that out? A tool like this, bringing them out here, where a lot of them haven't spent time, and really asking them to just reflect on that. That's the starting point, and I think that's a gift that we can give them, and hopefully that's the beginning of their process of figuring it out.